بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على خاتم النبيين صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وبعد، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today you have joined us again on the fourth edition, Benefits of Islam. The fourth benefit, according to my interpretation, would be the prayer itself. And this is in no particular order, but just a benefit. The prayer gives the human being the mental, the physical, and the spiritual combined into one. The Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, he stated before leaving this life, he said, As-salah, as-salah, the prayer, meaning to be cognizant, O you who believe, about the prayer. Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, one of the companions of the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, he said, the last thing that the slave leaves, meaning the slave, not this slavery that the human beings did, the slave of Allah, the human being, the servant slave of Allah, and this is a high appellate, this is a higher station, it's not something that is demeaning. So he stated, he said, the slave of Allah, the last thing he leaves in connection with the Creator is the prayer itself. Because the prayer is what connects the human being. Now in Islam, what we do is have the mental exercise, concentrating on the words of Allah, the spiritual and the physical. Because the physical movement will also bring about an impact into the heart. For example, when we pray, we say Allahu Akbar, we put our hands back like this, in order to throw all of the dunya, all of the world behind us, and to say that Allah is the great, meaning to say there is none greater than He. So we put all of the things that are worrying us behind us, and we concentrate on our worship of our Creator. Now when we say that, Allahu Akbar, and by the way folks, it's not a terrorist chant. It is not something that you say before you harm innocent human beings, and all of these Hollywood movies that are coming out. Oh, before he started to go and commit a crime, he went and said his prayer. This is something totally rubbish and ludicrous. It's something preposterous. And no decent Muslim would ever think of doing something like that in order to harm innocent human beings. This is something that Hollywood is perpetrating, and this is something that they should be careful in order to insult a whole 1.8 billion people around the world. Now, the prayer itself, when you say the prayer, you go down into ruku'. Ruku' means that you go halfway down. Now, somebody could be, as I remember one of the prayers that I was doing in a stairwell, I was in ruku' position, meaning to say that I was bent. And when I was bent, somebody opened the door and she said, "Oh, are you okay? Are you okay?" And she kept asking, "Are you okay?" until I had to break my prayer and said, "Yes, I am okay, but I was praying." So you see, even the physical movement itself, I mean, at that time it wasn't funny because, you know, she kept saying that and she was genuinely concerned and she wouldn't leave me even though I waved like that. But in any respect, the prayer itself is at that moment, when you are bending and to nothing in front of you, it has to impact the heart. So when it impacts the heart and the insides of the human being, it brings the human being to fruition, to make something good out of their life. So the prayer is a command in order to do the right things. The prayer should stop you from indecency. The prayer should stop you from vice. The prayer should stop you from doing things that are harmful. The prayer should actually make you a better human being. So at this point, for example, when you bend and bow, as for if you were to go to any country and meet the president, prime minister, the queen, whoever it is, you would not actually go and have an arrogant posture. So in Islam, obviously, the creator of the universe is much bigger than any human being. So even in that position of prayer, one actually goes down, and when you go down, you affect the inside, and then you come back up and you praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again, and then you go back down onto your forehead. And this forehead, the frontal lobe, that's why Allah says in the Quran, nasiyatin kadibatin khatiya, that Allah will drag the transgressor by the forelock. And now look, this is a miracle in the Quran itself, because the forelock is where all of the moral decision making is taking place. Whether to harm somebody, whether to do vandalism, whether to do antisocial behavior, anything that you are willing to do, all of the decision making is done on the forelock. So now we put this most esteemed position of our face onto the ground in order to become more humble, in order to gain humility, in order to gain piety, in order to acquire a sense of serenity. And this is what prayer teaches you. So you put your forehead onto the ground. For example, if I were to tap you on your back like that, you might feel a bit insulted. But if I were to do the same thing onto your face, you will feel even more insulted, because Allah has given the face a stature that it is something to be protected, because it's something that beautifies the human being. It gives it characteristics. Now, you put that face onto the ground to say that, look, from dust we come. From dust we are made, and from dust to dust we will return. This is what the prayer teaches you, to make you humble, to prioritize your life. For example, we wake up before sunrise. We wake up before sunrise in order to pray. Why? Why get out of your cushy beds? Why get something done at that point? Why not just sleep, and when you get up, you do the right thing? Well, I can make the same arguments. Why get up at 8 o'clock and go to work? Why? Why not just get up anytime, and your boss wants you at 8? You say, well, no, I don't care. I'm going to get there at 11 o'clock whenever I wake up, because I do whatever I want. Soon you will not be having a job. So Allah has prescribed the time, because the human being is nothing but time itself. Because the human being revolves around time. That's why it says in the hadith, it said, do not curse time, because time is with Allah. Time is with Allah. In His hands is time. Meaning to say that, you see, all these things about relativity and all of those things, every single thing that the human being does is revolved around time. Now, when you are a timed human being, you wake up before sunrise and you pray your prayer. And many of the great scholars used to stay up until the sun was high above, and they used to remember Allah, and they said this was the nourishment that we used to get. With this in mind, you come to the next prayer. It's called the Dhuhr prayer. And this is where the meridian is high up, when the sun is at high noon, and a little bit after, when you have one shadow's length that is being casted down. Now at this time, when the day is beginning to become complex, you start meditating again on where you are as a human being, and thanking God for all what He has given. And then you might have lunch before this or after this, and might take a small nap if you are given. If not, you go back to work. And then again, another prayer that comes is called Al-Asr, meaning to say this is the late afternoon prayer. And at this time, the hustle and bustle of the day, the tiredness, you take time out to relieve yourself from stress, you make wudu, you make ablution, you wash yourself, wash your hands, your face, and this is the way you come closer to the Creator of the universe, and you center yourself once again, prioritize your life, that nothing is harming you, nothing is above Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing can destroy you, meaning to say that you are your own key to success. Meaning a lot of people have anxiety, and the way to get rid of anxiety is the prayer itself. Then you have the Maghrib prayer, when the sun is coming down. When the sun is coming down, you start saying the Maghrib prayer, and you say it out loud. The Dhuhr and Asr prayer, you say it silently, because the whole world is busy, and you say it silently so that it would impact the heart. Look at the beauty of even that, so that the impact of the heart would take place. Then when in Maghrib, when the sun is coming down and the world is getting quieter and darkness is coming upon you, you again thank Allah, but at the same time you say your prayers out loud. So when the environment is quiet, you are louder, so again it would impact your heart. Then you have the Isha prayer, the late night prayer, when everything is silent, you would again say it out loud in order to affect your heart and bring everything into a capsule of success. This is what the prayer will give you. The prayer will give you a way to success, a way to understanding your life from beginning to end. Just like the prayer ends, you will also end one day. And this is a great benefit that Islam has given. Prayer is a pinnacle of success. If people really knew the power of prayer, they would be praying a lot more. We need people of prayer. We do not need more money. We do not need more lands. We do not need more buildings. What we need are serious worshipers. We need people who pray often, people who are content with their lives, and people who turn to God. And this is another benefit of Islam, as we have stated the other benefits, and these are the qualities of a believer that that would turn back to prayer and turn back to God Almighty. And we wish you well. So take a look into Islam to see how the prayer can benefit you. And if you're a Muslim watching, to not neglect your prayer and be negligent all your life. May Allah bless you and guide you. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.